The thing is, that hence the Michael between the orbit of the fixed stars or heaven and the surface of the earth or the elements. And he caused this cord to be marked along its way with frets to break the cord or to break the string of the one string instrument into the harmonic intervals. And he placed one fret in the exact center of the string, by means of which he secured the mystery of the octaves. And in so doing, he placed this fret in the position of the sun in relation to the solar system, the way the ancients studied it, so that he caused the absolute point of equilibrium of tone to correspond with the body of the sun. And he caused this in man to correspond to the sensual nature of the heart. And this sun, therefore, we come to again in alchemy. And from the salt and sulfur, the opposites, mingling together, we have in spirit united through matter, the middle distance of meridian four, the octave point on the thread or cord. And here we have the sun, which is the focal point of the world form, form being the perfect compound of spirit and matter. Now, as the sun occupies this mysterious central point, the sun is therefore gold, because the sun is produced alchemically in space by the mingling of the opposing elements. And all the great work of heaven and earth is achieved in the production of the sun, or gold, the core of the great world of metals. In this way, the philosophy of alchemy says that wherever there is absolute equilibrium, there is a sun, and that all planets and all other bodies are off balance. Wherever there is the sun, there is equilibrium. And the moment this equilibrium occurs, the sun becomes creative and causes to move from itself a series of unbalanced polarities and forms a solar system. And when the units forming this solar system are achieve balance within themselves, they each become a sun and generate again. Now in man, the Chinese say, he receives his spirit from imperial heaven, the yellow emperor. He receives his body from the great mother. He brings these two, spirit and matter, into equilibrium and produces a sun, S-U-N. And this sun is the soul. And the soul is therefore composed of gold. Not physical gold, but the same kind of gold is always created by equilibrium. The moment equilibrium is created in the alchemical mysticism, the gold within a thing is caused to be released. Because wherever there is gold, there is a potential equilibrium. And as I think I told you on another occasion, research at Dornach in Switzerland has shown that gold, colloidal gold, is a sovereign remedy for ailments of the heart. Heart, sun, gold, soul. They are all part of one sequence of values. Now, according to the Chinese, there is gold in everything, just as the Europeans have. Now, what is the gold in everything? What is the seed of gold that must always be present in every single thing that exists? The answer is that everything has within it a potential of equilibrium.
Above man in the scale of evolution are the gods, creators up on the spiritual and physical planes. And notice, ladies and gentlemen, they don't believe in one God, they believe in gods. In the course of evolution, you have risen above the plant, which has creative power only in the physical world, and have become like the gods, possessing creative power on both the mental and physical planes of being, besides intelligence and free will to direct it. This was accomplished by the diversion of one half of your sex force upwards for building a brain and larynx, organs which are still fed and nourished by this uplifting half of the sex force. But while the gods direct their whole creative force to altruistic purposes by the power of mind, you still squander one half of your divine heritage upon desire and sense gratification. If, therefore, you would become as they, you must learn to turn your whole creative energy upward to be used under the direction of your intelligence entirely. Thus only can you become as the gods and create from yourself by the power of your mind and the great word, whereby you may speak the creative fiat, remembering that physically you were once hermaphrodite, like the plant, and able to create from yourself. Look into the future now through the perspective of the past, and realize that your present unisexual condition is only a temporary phase of evolution, and that in the future your whole creative force must be turned upwards so that you shall become a hermaphrodite spiritually, and thus able to objectify your ideas and speak the living word, which shall endue them with life and make them vibrant with vital energy. This dual creative force, thus expressed through the brain and larynx, is the elixir vitae, which springs from the living stone of the spiritually hermaphrodite philosopher. The alchemical process of kindling and elevating it is accomplished in the spinal cord, where the salt, sulfur, mercury, and azoth are found. It is raised to incandescence by high and noble thought, by meditation upon spiritual subjects, and by altruism expressed in the daily life. The second half of the creative energy, thus drawn upward through the spinal canal, is a spinal spirit fire, the serpent of wisdom. Gradually, it is raised higher and higher, and when it reaches the pituitary body and the pineal gland in the brain, it sets them to vibrating, opening up the spiritual worlds and enabling man to commune with the gods. Then this fire radiates in all directions and permeates the whole body and its auric atmosphere, and man has become a living stone whose luster surpasses that of the diamond or the ruby. He is then the philosopher's stone.
All things have the possibility of being synthesized into balance. Now, if you remember in the Sefer HaZohar, the Kabbalistic Book of the Splendors, it says, unbalanced forces perish in the void. Thus passed the kings of Edom and the giants of ancient days. Your titans, your chaotic giants, fighting for control of the universe, represented your two great powers, the mother, father, dragon in China, that struggled together and produced between them the golden ball, which is the symbol of imperial China and also the symbol of the age of the world. Taoism is not a philosophy in which you do a great deal of talking. It is a philosophy in which you are forever accepting into yourself, not giving up. But in accepting into yourself, you prepare for the release of the splendor of the sun, for once this tremendous jewel of immortality is cast within yourself. You burst into a sun. And from that time on, you are raised warm and preserve all life. And you become the parent of another order of life. So the old hours, and it, they got through, they went up to heaven and became stars. What is the star? Just another symbol of the diamond soul. It is just another symbol of the radiant sun around which any water of life is going to grow. Because when men cease moving around the center, they cease to be planets and become suns. When human beings cease to move around their own centers, they cease to be wanderers and they become sages. And as they become sages, they become alchemists. They sitting quietly within the mysterious nature of themselves. They take that little furnace, which is the heart, which has the warmth within it, the point of fire and light, and in this heart they accomplish the creation of the universal medicine from the wise man's stone. In the alchemy itself, It is all this internal mystery of man ceasing to be a planet and becoming a sun, ceasing to be a base metal and becoming a star, ceasing to be a series of separate parts, each struggling for supremacy, and uniting these parts in their death and resurrection, that they may all become the vehicles or manifesting centers for the dissemination of Tao. For when this complete equilibrium is reached, and the silence and the mystery where all parts mingle, where the seven colors unite to restore the light light, in that center, Tao moves through. And moving into manifestation transforms man. For the planet is one who is moved to the sun, but the sun is one who moves the planets. And the spiritual source moves other things and is itself unmoved. But those who have not achieved this source are forever moved and have great difficulty in moving anything themselves. So in alchemy and the Chinese viewpoint, it is this creation of equilibrium and the release of the eternal.
So the counter movement is this, that at the end of the cycle, things get more and more out of control. And everybody, every individual, has the sense of powerlessness, that the government is out of hand, that nobody is put up for election whom we care to vote for, that the whole thing is a mess, and that you can't do anything about it, and the wars, which we don't want, get more and more imminent and dangerous. Yet at the same time, we are trying to control everything. And so government gets more and more uptight. And at the same time, since we are coming to the end of the cycle, in which the divinity wakes up from the dream, more and more people are beginning to have mystical experience. That is the waking up process. So then you get this really frightening picture, that as we move ineluctably towards the final colossal explosion, we all begin waking up, and we begin to see in our visionary experience the great white light. Well, what do you suppose that is? Why, that's the star you're going to turn into. The light of glory. God in the form of the sun, the greatest and most ancient symbol, even used by Christians, is when God is called the sun, S-U-N, of justice, and is born and in the form of Christ at the winter solstice, which is the period of the birth of the sun.
Next week, who knows? Oh, don't you tell me it's rough.